Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're going to learn halibut, lingcod, and coho salmon techniques out of Qualicum Rivers Winter Harbour in beautiful British Columbia. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolff and this is Angler West Television. Only a few miles from the full force of the Pacific Ocean, Winter Harbour has given refuge to those who braved the open ocean for centuries. Perfectly located near the tip of Vancouver Island, British Columbia, Winter Harbour is now home to Qualicum Rivers Winter Harbour Resort, still giving refuge to those who braved the open ocean in search of sport fishing success and adventure. The Yetis are stacked and ready to be filled with premium halibut, lingcod, rockfish, and salmon, all expertly handled by the lodge's captains. Built on what was once a commercial fish processing facility, Qualicum Rivers Winter Harbour has the ability to handle large catches of fish on a daily basis with plenty of ice and storage facilities. The real key, however, to an operation like Qualicum Rivers Winter Harbour is the knowledge and dedication of its captains. A day on the water at Winter Harbour is not only a good chance to catch a great load of fish, but also an opportunity to learn a great deal from one of the many experienced Winter Harbour captains. Today we're with Captain Dan Cox, heading out to the open ocean in search of halibut, lingcod, and rockfish. On a slightly rough day, but nothing we can't handle.
Yeah, a little bit of salmon belly here. I always hook it at the end here so it swims like a fish. And then it swims like a fish, it looks realistic. And a lot of halibut really like the salmon. Yeah, you know, I've caught the big ones on the herring too, so. There's a nice fat herring there. Put that baby out there and see what goes on here. We got some bait here, being procured here, so. I soaked it and I'm going to put some salmon with procure on it. I'm going to throw that down. I'll bring this fish over with the scent. Okay, I was setting up my lines there just to, I always do it before I anchor so I know which way I'm drifting, so I know which way to set my anchor. I'm going to run back up here now and get above my mark here and let my anchor go and drift right onto it. We're around 160 feet deep, between 155 and 160 feet deep. I got just off the mark, but we're on the outside of it, so we're okay, because we're still scenting out into the deep. And probably be, I figure about an hour to an hour and a half before we start getting any halibut. We'll get them scented in, and they'll get situated and probably bite for us. I usually tell everybody 1 hour. That usually happens, right? Come here?
Yep.
When the fish eats a herring, you gotta, on a circle, a lot of times they'll swallow it right down and you have to give it a good set, but you always gotta wait for them to eat it a couple times because you don't know how big the fish is down there. And if the fish is just small, it'll just have a hold of the bait. So that's usually why I tell people just to wait a minute. On salmon is different. They've gotta eat it all the way to the hook. But circle hooks usually hook up themselves, but like I say, if they get caught in the throat, you wanna give them a good set before they leave the bottom because they come off at the top sometimes. Yeah. this kind of weather, we can't be too choosy. Just bring it over this way, please. Thank you. Oh, there we go, another under.
Nice.
He did very well. Because, I mean, that fish is that small, and that piece of bait was this long. So you let him eat long enough where we got it hooked. We got it hooked good, too. So that's because you hit it hard like that. Because he probably had it down in his throat because we let him have it for about a while.
So I started to reel that up on the bottom. Got three or four cranks up and then just pinned.
It's good. This is a good thing. We're getting what we came for. Because we come out here, we wanted three chickens. So three chickens and a couple overs. But we're doing good.
Welcome back to British Columbia, where the bite is just starting to turn on.
I've got a whole half of carcass. The head's about this big and the carcass about this with the guts and the back part of the salmon. And I got to give it I call it a 10-minute rod. I got to give it lots of time to eat so it gets it right into its mouth so that it gets the hook in it. Sometimes they eat it by the head, but if they don't, you got to wait till it eats it up. So it's a kind of a guessing game, but I just let it eat for a while and it's usually get the fish. If I don't wait long enough, we just pull the carcass out of its mouth. So that's why I wait a long time to slide it over. Oh, okay. This one swallowed it. This is a bigger fish. Enough. Don't touch him. He'll settle down. Stop. That's enough. Hey. Come on. That's good. That's good. Enough.
That's rodeo.
Hey, that one swallowed it. The herring. We didn't set it hard enough. And watch what happens.
Yep. Just reeled right up.
The hook was in the throat. But, you know, that's one of the reasons why I say, tell people all the time, give it a real good hit when you're leaving the bottom. Because you'll feel it pop out like 5 inches and then it hooks into the mouth. Because sometimes when you get it up here, like that thing was straight up and down and he had a good, he could have just spit it out. But we got lucky. This is the carcass here. The fish was biting. It ate off most of the back here. It'll still be okay. They'll still eat that. It'll be a little easier for them to swallow the whole thing. But I'll put it back down. I'll just dip it into some of this pink stuff here.
I gotta be down just to a head.
There we go. Give it a little bit of taste. Throw it in there. Get it down fast so all that stuff doesn't wash off. And then we're getting a little bite here on our left-handed reel again. After this one comes up, we'll swap a rod over.
Yeah.
Obviously, a key to halibut fishing is bringing halibut to your bait by creating a scent trail. On another boat, Phil Pirone of Procure, Barbara Helm, and Jason Hambley of Procure are fishing with Bob Forrester, and there's no shortage of scent being used on this boat.
For bait, what we're putting out here is a glow tiger prawn, the bigger size hoochie. It's got to be glow, it's got to be tiger prawn, and two herring. We've got a scent them in. We're using lots of bait today, and we're going to put a little Procure on that to bring them in even faster. 220 of water, one of my favorite spots. Good to go. Give a little juice on there.
Fill it up the belly cavity with the garlic tuna oil, bloody tuna oil, and we're gonna send it down.
Little trick my dad taught me. You're running out of bait, you're getting down to the last few and they're eating the herring. Put a piece of stainless wire right onto the eye of the hook. put the fish on as per usual, and then wrap the stainless right around the fish, down the body a little ways, and then poke the stainless right back into it again. And this fish can actually reel in a couple of halibut without burning up a herring.
This little light, we get it over at Fishfield, it glows and blinks in the dark. This is a red one, I believe, and it blinks, and it, we can use them on crab traps, but it really works good on halibut. And last year we tried them on our jigs for Lingcod, and we, about 2-1 with this light blinking, they found it. So it really works well.
So you just slide it down the leader?
Yeah, or put it on a snap, it on one of the snaps.
On one of the snaps.
Right on the bottom, they'll find it. You can put it
right
on your lead. That's right there, yep, you bet.
Perfect.
And the combination of the blinking light and the Procure Sense, we usually do really well with it. And I've had some guys in Oregon using these, and they love them.
Well, this would be awesome to try something new for a change. Instead of the same old, same old.
Yeah. Sometimes when you're halibut fishing, you drop down, and you hit them right in the nose, and it's instant action. But a lot of times, you got to wait for scent trail to happen. And these fish, they'll swim for miles to follow a scent trail, but they're always looking for something to eat. And once that scent trail, you can go like an hour sometimes without a bite, and all of a sudden, all four rods will go down. They'll just, the whole school of halibut will show up all at once, and that will happen. It's an absolute circus. So we have a couple of baits rigged with the garlic bloody tuna oil, and then we got a couple of baits rigged with the butt juice. Totally different scent pattern. Butt juice is ground up salmon eggs and fish oil, anise, and amino acids. And it's a lot different. And usually, some days both scents work, but usually one of those scents, either the garlic base or the anise base, one of them will get them going.
We've anchored up for halibut and established a scent trail, but while we're waiting for the halibut to come, dropping a jig down is a good idea.
What you got on, Barb?
I don't know.
And you really do never know what you're gonna hook.
Whoa.
Be patient.
Whoa.
Oh, is that one of those baskets?
That's a basket.
Okay.
You got that?
Let's back
Look
up a bit
beauty.
Into the boat.
That's a basket starfish.
That is a beauty.
Wow.
I just got one of those out of Pacific City last week, so I know what it is. And all that stuff, they all wiggle and move.
See that lacy? So pretty.
Isn't that weird that we're talking about it today and we got one? I guarantee any guy you're going to have fishing knows what that is, except for maybe Barbara.
I think it'd be nice to try it sometime.
Well, that's what I tried to do, but it fell apart.
All right. Oh, it's still alive?
Oh, yeah. And you turn it over. You can see, it's a starfish.
There's unfolding for us.
See, I'm all moving, the tentacles are moving and wiggling.
Isn't it gorgeous?
I have never seen one before.
Beautiful.
Oh, there it's falling apart already.
Okay, well, let's set her free then.
Yeah. That'll work.
Nice work.
The lingcod and rockfish are of great quality in these nutrient-rich waters, and jigs, like the Fishfield leadfish jig, which are found on all the Winter Harbor boats, are a fun and effective lure for these great-eating fish. On another boat, Haibin Wang from Fishfield and a couple of friends are loading up with lingcod and rockfish with Captain Felix Geyser.
I'm using a leadfish, 150 gram. It's called, the color is a cotton candy, and it's still the two-hook setup. This is my first decent fish this morning. Let's find out what it is. Oh, the lingcod. Right on.
Nice fish.
Nice.
Awesome.
Ooh, that's a beauty.
That's a good fish on that light gear there. Yeah. Seems like this second hook at the top seems to be getting probably 80% of the hookups, I'd say.
Exactly.
And yeah, these jigs are killing them. I'm really impressed. I like them. Nice and light, but still very effective. And they catch lingcod like that.
Cool.
Good job, buddy.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Lingcod are extremely aggressive, and it's not uncommon for one lingcod to grab onto a hooked rockfish, something we call hitchhiking. but it is a little unusual.
Two of them.
To pick up two hitchhikers at the same time.
Very slow.
Drop your jig down, right now.
Get him right there.
Oh, you grabbed it again. Okay, pull it up slow. No, drop it back down.
We got one.
Okay, well, there seems to be lingcod on this rock, so see what else we can get here.
I'm using 55-pound braided line, and with a bobber stopper. This one is 2X large. The reason I put it on is because when you're doing bottom fishing, a lot of times you crank up too quick, and the swivel might bust your ceramic guide. So this one will protect your guide. And I put a swivel on here with a 3 feet, 30-pound fluorocarbon leader. I don't know if you have to put a fluorocarbon, but I do. And then come down here, it's a swivel with a Dulux snap. Put the jig on here, and this is two hook setup.
All right, so I dropped down one of those fish fill jigs of cotton candy, and you know, sometimes you know, we're trying to catch lingcod. But I think I've got a big halibut on here now, which is not unusual to catch one on a jig. It might be a little unusual to actually get it in the boat, though, because I've got, I think, 20-pound P-line here, maybe 30-pound. Hold on, boys.
Okay. Unfortunately,
holy smokes,
this fish is above the legal size limit, so it will have to be released. But still a whole lot of fun on an Avet Raptor reel.
Okay, so here's that jig that I was using to catch that big halibut. Of course, we're trying to catch lingcod, but the big halibut took it, and that's fine. But, all right, so here's why you want to use assist hooks. Okay, this is a 400-pound assist hook on here, and that's what actually caught the halibut. This hook, this is the one that was on the front here, and you can see what happened to that. That big halibut just straightened that hook right out. So if I didn't have this assist hook on, there's no way I would have gotten that halibut in. And the way I set this jig up, they come straight, but what you want to do is put a little S-curve bend in them. An easy way to do that on a boat like this is just put it right on the rail of the boat and just push. And it's not too hard to do, but it puts a nice little action in your bait. Now the paint, you can see, has come off a little bit. Now we beat the heck out of this jig today. It's caught a lot of fish. But the paint on these jigs is not as tough as the other lead fish jigs because these are designed to bend. If you put that hardener on that paint on this jig, it wouldn't bend right and it wouldn't work. So that's why the paint will start to chip on this, but still catch a lot of fish on these before the paint will come off. Now, I was putting a little Anna's Bloody Tuna on a jig, that halibut, when it hit. So that was a heck of a deal.
Welcome back to Winter Harbor on the northwest corner of Vancouver Island, British Columbia. I'm Justin Wolff. We're fishing out of Qualicum Rivers Winter Harbor, which is just off Quatsino Sound, a natural gathering place for coho salmon.
Big hook nose northern.
Ooh.
Beautiful fish, man. On the light spinning gear. Yeah. Love that. So we're just anchored up on one of the creek mouths here just out of Winter Harbor. And the coho here are stacked out front, waiting to go in the creek. And they love spinners. So we're anchored up casting spinners and getting these big northern coho. Northern coho are usually coho 15 pounds and over. And you can tell them by their big hook jaw there. And so, we'll just keep plugging away here. We've only been here for a few minutes, and we've already got two. So we'll keep going and see what else we can get.
Okay, maybe we're on to something.
Nice, beautiful coho there. Oh yeah. Look at that. Okay.
This one is on the fish field, pink hoochie glitter. Trim it a little bit so it's not too big, and it works.
Yeah, those spinners with the pink hoochies on them seem to be really doing the job here.
Killer.
Awesome. Great fish. Good job.
Thanks. Okay, this is our fish for the hoochie. This is a hot pink color with the glitter in. And the regular size is 5 inches. I trim it a little bit so that seems work better.
Yeah, it's a really fun fishery with the light gear as well. We're not using downriggers, we're not using anything. Just little spinning rods, spinners. You can even get them on the fly here if you fly fish. Good job, buddy. You pretty much put it right on that fish, eh? Oh yeah, look at that thing. Just tearing it up. Is that out? Awesome fish. Beauty. Northern coho, probably about 15 pounds again on the spinner. They're not even rolling, they're just here.
This is a crazy one.
Good job, man.
The limit for these fish are 2 per person per day, possession limit of 4. And they're a great eating fish, nice firm red meat, great table fare, and good fun as well. So, yeah, keep them coming.
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.